Thank you very much for being still here, despite I'm sure you are very hungry. Some lessons speaking about food, so maybe you must be a bit patient. Okay? So thank you also to the organization for inviting me and all the team that has prepared this paper. And first of all, I must tell you, I heard in a meeting last day that we have to be patient with projects. In this case, these projects began some 15 years ago when I still was a graduate student. So I think that being patient is important. This project is about, as you can see, the importance of traditional knowledge on the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity, and it is about an official Spanish inventory of traditional knowledge. As you can see, it is a big team that groups nearly every, still every big team of Spanish ethnobotanists, we are all working together. So it's the nicest thing, in my opinion, of this project is just we have gathered really all the teams which are working in Spain in ethnobotany. Well, you all know what is traditional knowledge, and there is no need to tell it to you. But when you do an inventory, you have problems for deciding if something has to be in the inventory or not. Is this traditional or not? You know that it is knowledge, practices, and beliefs about indigenous and local communities. It's developed through the experience of the community. It is transmitted through generations. This is also basic. And it must be adapted to local culture and environment. But we all know that traditional knowledge is very dynamic, and then it's sometimes difficult to see what happens. We can do also a question: do we really need inventories of traditional knowledge? As we know, this knowledge is very important for the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity. And this has been highlighted by international conventions such as the CBD. Therefore, the CBD promotes developing national strategies for recording and preserving TK, or TEK, how you like to tell, related to biodiversity. In fact, a number of governments, they are now in the process of implementing this article of the CBD, and they are creating environmental laws, policies that protect and ensure the appropriate use of the traditional knowledge, and inventories of traditional knowledge are being created in several countries. Why are traditional knowledge inventories helpful? They are helpful tools, as you can see, for maintaining, preserving, and promoting traditional knowledge. And traditional knowledge, as you know, it's very useful for the sustainable use of biodiversity. It's useful for people, they rely on the knowledge, and it's useful because it's a knowledge that helps the sustainable use of biodiversity. But these inventories, they also help to the preventive, so it's called the preventive protection of traditional knowledge, which is something we know it's important, since they avoid the misappropriation of traditional knowledge, mainly against patents or industrial design. As you know, a condition for patentability is novelty and to invent. And if something is published, then there is no novelty. So this kind of patents can be revoked. They take money and time, but they can really revoke. So this is important. In the case of Spain, the Act or the Law 42/2007 on Natural Heritage and Biodiversity, this law, a very recent law as you can see, mandates to preserve, to maintain and promote, so this is really the translation of the law, traditional practices of interest for the conservation and sustainable use of the natural heritage and biodiversity. The law also promotes equitable sharing of benefits following CBD and so on, and the law promotes inventories of traditional knowledge relevant to the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity, but also of geodiversity, and it says specifically on ethnobotanical knowledge. You can imagine that there was an ethnobotanist behind this law. This law also creates this inventory, the Spanish inventory of traditional knowledge related to natural heritage and biodiversity, and this inventory is a part of an integrated database, a big database, the Spanish Inventory of Natural Heritage and Biodiversity. This big integrated database includes another 11 inventories. For example, the catalog of endangered species, you can see the catalog of endangered habitats, a catalog of forests, a catalog of protected areas, of seed banks, and so on. So it is just in the middle of very important inventories for sustainable use of biodiversity. The project I am now presenting, our aims, it was called the first stage for developing this inventory. So we had to create the inventory. First of all, we had to define what is the content of the inventory, because it may be very easy to know what is the content, but as I told you in the beginning, this was not so easy when you begin to decide if something must be or not entered in this inventory. We had to create the structure of the database, which we are all used to. We had to create a standard classification of traditional knowledge that could include not only botanical knowledge, but also zoological, mineralogic, etc. We had to create the idea, structure of the inventory, and we had to begin with some examples, and then we had to put information on 15 ethnobotanical publications in the database, and we had also to create individual dossiers of 50 species and of management practices to see how this inventory could be developed. We then had, as I told you, to compile published information. We can only include published information because the government said they didn't want to publish, to be there the first publishers, because maybe the researchers, they didn't have, for example, the prior informed consent. So to be sure that they are not having problems with that, they just accept published information that should have this prior informed. It is about biodiversity, but also about geodiversity, but also about ecosystem management. This was something that was perhaps the most new thing. We have all seen since many years ago how to do this organism databases, species is used for that, and so on. But this ecosystem management, this was not so easy to create a structure for that. We also create a repository of the publications for internal use, so that every researcher could have access and shouldn't need to go to the library, because you know sometimes it is difficult. So this was a very useful tool we created. And as I told you, we are a team of more than 16 ethnobiologists. Most of us, we are ethnobotanists, and we are from more than 20 research centers and universities. Well, first of all, the content, as I told you. A later royal decree, but very new, as you see, from 2 years ago, this establishes the content and the structure, but in very general lines. It says that traditional knowledge should be included only relevant for the sustainable use and conservation of biodiversity and geodiversity. This is sometimes also difficult to know. Is it so important for biodiversity? I think so. But everything is not important. And if you don't have a clear idea of the content, then it is a not viable project, because everything can be there. Well, then traditional knowledge, we have spoken what is traditional knowledge, but then we ask us, how can we be sure that the published material meets these requirements? First of all, we avoid sources, which are very popular sources speaking about what plants are good for. And we only use field-based ethnobiological references, and we divided into historical sources, so before 1900 and later ones. So we decided only to include, also for making it really viable, this kind of sources. So the sources should speak really how people living in a particular location, they think that this plant is useful or is good for. And we accepted all the information that was shared in the community for a certain time. But there are many publications that they don't give you this information. So we had to decide in every source. Well, the database. The database, according to the law, says that it should be a descriptive narration with geographical localization. And also something important is that it allows for the evaluation of the vulnerability and conservation. It is about plants, so I will show you two principal databases. One about plants, animals, and minerals, how they are named, how they are used, and the other is how the ecosystems are traditionally managed. So the structure is very, very different. It includes four principal tables, one about names, which is a different thing, one about uses, beliefs, so uses in a very broad sense. Another about land races, because land races, they have a very deep important information about management techniques different from normal species. And the other about ecosystem management practices. Here is the structure, you know about databases, a main table giving information with, from other satellite tables. That's the information with only our 15, the selection of 15 publications. You can see nearly 30,000 name reports, nearly 40,000 use reports, information in the case of names about nearly 2,000 species, in the case of use reports, so more than 1,600 species, most of them vascular plants, they work in the botanical works, but also something about fungi, animal, and so on. In the case of the food categories, you can see that the most important in the number of species is medicine, so many species, but also human food, animal food, and so on. And here I will show you some examples of what of the dossiers we have presented. I have told you we have three main dossiers, organism and biodiversity elements. They have the same structures, how they are named, how they are used. Different dossiers for land races, I will show you later, and different dossiers, very, very different for the ecosystem management practices. These are the main structure of the dossier, the name, the description, the habitat, the traditional knowledge, the historical references, the assessment, which is something quite interesting in this project, and the references. First of all, an example of the local names. This is a very important species in Spain, Chiliadenus glutinosus or Hassonia glutinosa, however you like. And here are the names. The names in the different languages of the country, Terroca, so very different, or Terroquer, nearly the same in Catalan. Also the traditional knowledge, the uses. Here it is used for preparing liqueurs. It is used for preparing teas, daily teas, or however you like to call them, but also modernly for preparing ice creams, so lots of things. It is also useful, for example, for trapping flies, here you can see, but also for whitening your teeth. So, and this is one of the plants with very few uses. So there are really plants with a lot of uses. Then we go to the assessment. What do we want to have in an assessment of a plant, which is something that the law told us to do? The assessment consists of an expert assessment, so the the researcher who do the dossier, he takes the information from the database, and we look for if the plant is just locally used, if the use is abandoned, or if it's still in use, and things like that. So here is, I show you an assessment of one of the species. And this assessment, the law says that it should be repeated every 10 years. Maybe we will not, but it's a good idea to see how things are evolving, how people are adapting. This is a land race dossier. Here you can see three. And you can see that it has many other information, because in the case of traditional varieties, we think that it's very important to see how they are managed, how the seed are managed, how the soil is managed, and things like that. So this is a longer information for each land race. And finally, I will show you how we manage with this ecosystem management, traditional ecosystem management dossiers. We have, after thinking, we have decided that we had to show how the different ecosystems in the country, you can see them, they are according to the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. So, different models of how people manage these kind of ecosystems. So for this first stage, we choose two ecosystems, one in a swamp place in the south, in Doñana, and how the ESAs, Juan de ESA, you know, these important agroecosystems in the, mainly in the west of Spain. And we choose representative examples of how these ecosystems are traditionally managed. The structure of the dossier is simple, a description of the place, a description of the traditional knowledge, some historical references, also an assessment of the experts who did the dossier and their references. In the case of Doñana, a very popular place for bird watchers, perhaps you have been there. Here you can see in the very south of Spain, near very near Morocco, and it's a wonderful place. I really invite you to visit if you can. So here is the dossier, and I will present some results of the dossier. For example, we divide all the traditional knowledge in the very different, because we did a classification of human activities like livestock management, forestry, hunting, fishing, gathering, water management, management of geological resources, and finally symbolic sociability activities. Okay, in this case, for example, we had the management of you can see the horses, but also cows. In the case of the forestry, it was a swamp place, so we hadn't any forestry activities. For hunting, it was traditionally to hunt deers, but also wild boar, aquatic birds, rabbits, hares. Many of these activities are now forbidden, so they are not made anymore. For fishing, you have eels, sturgeons, crabs, prawns, so quite a lot of important activities. For gathering, we have plant gathering for medicinal purposes, for many of the purposes here, for example, for thatching, it was important. Water management, we showed before how water was managed in Oman, so this kind of activities. Salt mines were there also, and finally there are important symbolic, like for example virgin pilgrimage and so on. It's very important. So there is one place there where, which 1 million people goes every year, so in 2 days lots of people go there. And so finally, for concluding, this inventory wants to offer researchers, policymakers, managers, but also the general public, an open access tool with the main ecological knowledge of Spain. So it will be open access for everybody, and published in online, free. And it will also establish, we want to establish the scientific framework and the methodological tools for developing future research, because we really found that many of the things which are publicated, they don't have most of the information for valuing, for assessing or evaluating this traditional knowledge. And finally, thank you very much for listening.